All right. Praise God for everybody's here who's here today. I thank God for the word of God. I just thank you for feasting on the word and the revelation God has in his word. Thoroughly convinced, as we all should be, that God wants us to know the revelation of his word more than we want to know it. And if you seek, you'll find it. They that seek after righteousness shall be filled. So hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. And just been again, still thinking about faith, and I've been talking about faith, and it just was laid on my heart to make sure that, you know, 2 Timothy says to study to show yourself approved unto man, rightly dividing the word of truth. We just have to make sure that we keep the word in line, keep it in order. And I want to talk about faith, and I love faith, and I want to make sure that we're working at doing what we can to strengthen our faith, to troubleshoot our faith, to diagnose any issues so we can see the manifestation and the end of our faith, for the simple fact that without faith, it's impossible to please God. But it's also very important that we keep in mind that faith worketh by love. The root of faith works by love, and without love, faith won't work. I was looking at this particular car. It's a third row BMW, no, not BMW, third row Mercedes-Benz SUV. Beautiful leather on the inside. It had every option you could ever want. Literally, if you've, it said in the reading, it said that it looks for parking spaces for you. And then when you get to the parking space, it'll park you. It'll just back it. It'll back itself up. You know, sometimes you pull up to that parking space and you can't tell if it's big enough. This car, it'll let you know if the parking space, if it can fit, and then it'll fit you into the parking space. I'm like, oh my God. I mean, rear cameras, this car had everything, all the bells and whistles. And this is like my dream car right now. It's only $68,000, no biggie. beautiful car. But you know, I could take that car and set it on. It could be shiny. You know, it shines so brightly. Off the showroom floor, if it doesn't have gas in it, that big, pretty, beautiful car is not moving anywhere. And we know that without faith, it's impossible to please God. But faith worketh by love. And only a mustard seed faith is what it takes, you know, to get your faith come to fruition. But just that little mustard seed faith shows you how powerful faith is, if that's all it takes to move a mountain. But as much as that little bit of faith can do, it can't do anything if it's not working by love. Faith works by love. Just like that car isn't going to move an inch without gas in the tank, no matter how many options it has. I mean, they went on and on about the size of the engine and all the things this car could do. Without gas, that car, baddest car on the block, it's not going anywhere without love. Without gas, and our faith isn't going anywhere if we're not working by love. So we can find out how faith works. We can understand what it takes to move our faith, what it takes to strengthen our faith, to build on our faith. All these things are very important. But if it's not founded in love, our faith isn't going anywhere. So it's important that we keep love at the heart of it. God is love. So thinking about just still, of course, faith, and I was reading about Martin Luther. He's a monk in the 1500s who was part of the Reformation, the Protestant Reformation, because previously during that time, during the 16th century, the church was very, very legalistic. It was works were, they were very works-based, and you had to work to get to heaven, and they taught everyone that you had to, it was how much you punished yourself. If you did these things, if you flogged yourself, if you went without food, if you did all these things, this sacrifice that you made was what made you worthy to go to heaven. That's what got you a seat to heaven. On the other side, though, if you had lots and lots of money, you could also pay the church to save you a seat in heaven, which was very interesting. Rich people, they didn't have to live as holy because they had enough money to pay the church so that they would have a seat in heaven, or they would pay to have themselves or a member of their family have a role in the church so that that would keep them a seat in heaven. And it was also interesting that, you know, for those people who weren't poor enough, to who were poor, and they weren't rich enough to buy their own seat in heaven. They had all these different things, these hoops that they had to jump through in order to earn their place in heaven. So if you committed to, you know, being flogged 39 times, let's say you just, I can't take it anymore, 36 times, they actually had it set up that you could spend money, you could pay and get a certificate to say that you did all 39, which would be your ticket into heaven. I mean, it was so hypocritical. They had these different things. The church was so based on making money back then, and it was condemnation. It kept people under condemnation, just like we know that the law does now. I mean, if you're in the law, it produces condemnation. It's the ministration of condemnation. So it was, they were, you know, the church was built up on that at that time. And this man, Martin Luther, was a man who was very much living a life of condemnation. He was always trying to make himself righteous. He was always trying to do the right thing, trying to, do these acts that would make him worthy. And we all know there's no way you can work. You can't do enough works to be worthy. And so he would do these things. He would make these sacrifices. He actually became a monk. And he basically said in so many words that he became one of the best monks ever, because he was able to, you know, it wasn't as hard for him to make these sacrifices, to be cold, to be hungry, and all these things. And he said, you know, if we really could go to heaven based on those things, he would probably be one of the best ones. And so in his effort to be righteous, in his effort to understand scriptures like Romans 1:17, that says, the just shall live by faith, the righteous shall live by faith, he couldn't understand how his righteousness would allow him to live by faith. And so he pursued, how do I get righteous enough that I can live by faith? Or salvation comes by righteousness. And he was, you know, he just tortured himself trying to figure out how he could be righteous enough to get salvation. But the thing about it is, the one thing about, like I just mentioned, they that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. So here's this man who's this Catholic Protestant monk who's seeking all these things, and he's been taught the ways of the Catholic Church, and he's been taught all this condemnation and legalism. He started seeking the Word of God, and God gave him the revelation that he sought. And so he started getting into the Word of God, and he came to Romans 3:28, and that was his revelation. That was just what opened up everything for him. It says, therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. So he said at one time, he said, at last, meditating day and night by the mercy of God, I began understanding that the righteousness of God is that through which the righteousness live by. That didn't copyright, but it's just basically he realized that righteousness was a gift of God, namely faith. And he said, here, as I felt entirely born again, that I had entered paradise itself through the gates that had been flung open. So it just opened his world. It just, you know, it created a whole new world for him once he realized that you were supposed to live by faith, but the righteousness was a gift from God. So he stopped trying to be righteous, and he began to accept righteousness. And it was this revelation that he took to the church, and he started announcing his new beliefs, and the 95 Theses on the door of the church, and this word got out about what he was believing, and it just created complete reformation. And revelation will do that. When you get revelation straight from God, you can create a reformation. You can change the world. His revelation changed the world, the then world, and that built a foundation for what we believe now. You know, that reformation is still going on as we get the revelation that the just shall live by faith, that this righteous, the life that I live by the faith of the Son of God. He got that revelation, and we're building on that revelation now. But in all of his revelation, you know, he was, you know, such a scholar of the word, you know, very smart man, very educated man. He taught others, and it was so interesting. As he was teaching them all the legalism that he had been taught himself, he started getting in the word, and he had to start teaching differently. And so he was creating scandal because he wasn't teaching what everybody else was teaching, because the revelation was coming to him, and he started teaching what God had started showing him. So all of these things, it just created such reformation in the church that it was a game changer at that time. But in his study, he came up to the book of James, and he came to James chapter 2, verse 24, and he said, "Ye see then," this chapter and verse says, "Ye see then how that by faith, by works, a man is justified, and not by faith only." So, you know, I guess his revelation came to a screeching halt because in his mind, he couldn't reconcile this verse with all of the verses he found in Romans and in Ephesians that said, the just shall live by faith. It says, it's not our works that saves us, but it's our faith that saves us. So he got to James, and at one point in time, he actually believed that the book of James wasn't even supposed to be in the canonical Bible, that it wasn't even supposed to be a part of the Bible because he, in his understanding, couldn't make it fit. But we know that it's important, as it says in 2 Timothy 2:15, that we have to rightly divide the word of truth. We have to understand the word is in perfect harmony, and if we don't understand how it fits together, we have to get in the word and get a better understanding, because God's word is true and it's in perfect harmony. And so I was just reading this, and eventually he did come to the revelation of how it all fits. You know, the word of God is just fascinating. But I got into James 2:24 and just started going verse by verse. You know, because Martin Luther was looking at Romans 3:28 that says, we conclude that a man is justified by faith. He was reading all these different verses. Ephesians says in chapter 2, verse 8 through 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So we all agree, amen, that we are saved by faith. We're not saved by our works. That's what the word of God says, and we believe that. But then James is saying something here that had Martin Luther and a lot of Christians today confused about how works actually fits in, so that this is still the word of God and it still is in harmony. And I was reading through this chapter, James chapter 2, and on verse 14, he says, what does it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and hath not works? Can faith save him? Now, again, we go back and the word says that we're saved by faith. But James, it's like he's questioning what Paul said. But these are men of God. They were inspired by God, by the Holy Ghost, to write the word of God. So he says, what does it profit? So there's an end game. There's a conclusion to this. What is the profit of our faith if we say we have faith and have not works? Now, the interesting part of that, he says, we say we have faith. So we can say we have faith. Is it possible for us to say we have faith and not really be in faith? I believe so. And even the examples that James uses to support his statement, he says, well, you know, I can say that I'm pregnant, but in about 9-10 months, there's supposed to be a fruit. There's supposed to be something that expresses what I say. So it's one thing to say, you know, what you believe, but it's another thing to actually produce the fruit of what you believe. And we talk about this saying, if you go to Romans 10, and this is so good. But again, in Romans 10, Paul is just, you know, he at the beginning of this chapter, he's talking about the Israelites, and he's talking about the Jews at that time. He said, my heart's desire for Israel is that they might be saved. He wanted them to be saved. He said, I bear record that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. So basically, they were saying, you know, they had heard the word. They had heard Paul preaching. They had heard Peter, the apostles, preaching the word. But they still went back and said, you know, that's good. But, you know, I've put in too much time. You know, I've worked too hard to get where I am to just throw this all away and accept what you're saying. For you to say that my salvation comes simply by faith, and all of this work and all this time that I've put in, all these years that I've spent, you know, doing these things, you want me to just throw that away and accept what you're saying? They were not ready to be submitted to that. They weren't ready to give away or to let go of all of their works. So they weren't ready to see that that was all for nothing. They were so invested in what they had done, almost, you know, proud of what they had done. You know, this is what I've done. I've lived a good life. And how many times have we heard that Christian say, I don't drink and I don't smoke and I don't curse and I go to church every Sunday and I pay my tithes and I can tell you all the things that I do. But to say all those things would be for me to say, That's my righteousness. That's what gets me into heaven. That's my salvation. But we know that's not the case. But the Israelites weren't ready to be submitted to. It said they have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. They literally refused to say, your righteousness is good, God, but I'm gonna hang on to mine. I'm gonna go with this because I anything that we've put in time in, you know, where your heart is, there your treasure is. If I spend a lot of time on something, if I put a lot of work into something, it's something I'm proud of, you know. And they, you know, that's where they were coming from. I've just invested. I've been living this way for too long just to walk away from all this and just to say, I'll take your righteousness, God. And I thought that's almost as if I was to go to class. And, you know, after I've done all the assignments that were, you know, given to me, I've worked hard, I studied, I stayed up nights and weekends and did all this studying. But my teacher comes to me and says, you know what, I'll take the test for you. I have all the answers already. I'll go ahead and take the test. You don't have to take the test. And I say, you know what, no, I've put too much work in this. I'm pretty confident that if I take this test, I'm going to get straight A's. No, I'm going to take the chance on my ability to finish this test. I appreciate it, you know, but I think I got this one. And on top of that, if we go back to James, which you don't have to turn back to, but in James 2 and 10, it says, for whosoever shall keep the whole law, yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. So not only will I take the chance on me taking this test myself, my teacher is telling me, are you sure you want to do this? Because if you miss one point on this test, you can flunk the whole test. Are you sure you want to take the chance with this test? I'll take the test for you. You can already get an A. It's in the bag. Nah, you know that's okay. I'm going to go ahead and give it a shot. I'm going to go ahead and try and take this test because I'm fully confident in my own ability to take this test, and I believe that I'm going to get an A. Now, if we look at it like that, that makes absolutely no sense, but somehow that's how a lot of Christians have been living life. They've been saying, you know what, I'm just going to keep trying harder and harder. You know, what's the song? We've sang it so many times in church many years ago. Lord, I'm running, trying to make 100. 99 and a half won't do. And it won't do. That's why I had to stop running. My righteousness is him. And he ran. He finished the race, praise God. And he took the test for me. And I thank him that I live in his righteousness, praise God. So Moses says that if you're going to by the righteousness of the law, that's what you live by. Verse 4, it says, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. So at this point, it's not up to us anymore. It's his righteousness, the end of the law to everyone that believeth. And that we understand, and there's layers to this. We understand that we don't just, once we accept his righteousness, then we start living any kind of way. And I have to put this caveat in here because I don't want anybody to listen to this and believe that, okay, I have his righteousness, that means I can live any kind of way. That's not what I'm saying, but I do accept his righteousness, and there are things that are going to go, that are going to shift into place, that are going to start clicking once I accept his righteousness, that I'm going to start living according to who I am, as long as I begin to identify with the righteousness of Christ. Once we accept that, then we start living after Christ. So he says, Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth, but they wanted to hang on to the law. Verse 5, for Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which doeth these things shall live by them. Again, the teacher is saying, are you sure you want to do this? Are you sure you want to take this test? Because if you take this test, this is your grade for the whole quarter. You miss one thing, it's a wrap, it's over. Are you sure? So this is what Paul is telling them. You know, if this is how you're going to do it, you're not going to be under the law and under grace, and under the law and under grace, you're going to be hot or cold. You're going to be one or the other. Are you sure this is what you want to accept? And he was preaching this to the Jews, and many of them were just like, I'm going to stay where I am. You know, we don't like change. Sometimes change is hard, and sometimes even getting that revelation. When we're comfortable, you know, there are things, we endure so many things much longer than we have to because it's not uncomfortable enough. It's not painful enough. You know, how many times, you know, a lot of the older people are notorious for this. You know, they get sick and they never go to the doctor. They never go get checked out or anything like that because the pain hasn't gotten bad enough for me to go see a doctor. The pain hasn't gotten bad enough for me to get checked out. You know, I can deal with this. And that's what it is. As long as I can deal with this, as long as I can put up with it, I'll just, you know, keep dealing with it as it is, and I'm not going to worry about it, you know. But God, And that's why a lot of things end up coming to us. Not that God is bringing them to us, but he's allowing them because he knows we with our stubborn selves are not going to change. We're not going to pursue the revelation because I'm comfortable. It's okay. It's not too bad. I don't want to live a life that's not too bad. I want so much more of what God has for me. And as long as I'm willing to just accept it's not too bad, or I can handle it, it's okay, then, you know, I can live in mediocrity if I want to, and we can stay there. That's just not good enough for me, praise God. Verse 6, but the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. And man, I got to tell you, I was reading this, and I've read it. You know, we've all read this, verse 6, so many times, but God just... But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in thy heart, who shall ascend into heaven? That is, to bring Christ down from above. Or who shall ascend into the deep? That is, to bring up Christ again from the dead. So what is he saying with that? So I have to believe, you know, what is it going to... He's basically telling the Jews, what is it going to take for you to believe? Who's going to bring Jesus down so you can see him? Who's going to bring him up from the dead so you can touch his hand? If we go to John chapter 20, verse 24 through 29, we read about, man, because of this passage of scripture, Thomas actually, you know, will always be known as Doubting Thomas. And it says, verse 24, but Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. And the other disciples therefore said unto him, we've seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my fingers into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. I will not believe. He made a conscious decision not to believe. And after 8 days again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, peace be unto you. Then saith he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. But Jesus said, but he said unto Thomas, because you've seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen, and yet have believed. So here we are, Paul is telling them, who's going to go get Christ for you so you can really believe it? Who's going to have him evidenced so you can really see him in his flesh or in you know, where you can touch and believe this? That's the only way you're going to really believe that this is how righteousness is received, that you have to take on his righteousness. That's not going to happen. And then if we go back to, I think I have it in the notes. Well, again, I can say that Paul himself was a testimony to the reality that one could believe in Jesus without actually seeing Jesus, because Paul never saw Jesus, and he wrote the most of the New Testament, and he had more revelation than any apostle in the any of the 12 disciples. And even Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16 through 19, you know, even though Peter spent all this time with Jesus on the earth, he said, for we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. He said, we saw it. I was there. I was an eyewitness. I didn't hear about this. I saw this. He said, for he received from God the Father honor and glory when there was came such a voice to him from the excellent glory. This is my beloved son, and who I'm well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the holy mount. And he said, we have also a more sure prophecy. He said, I was there. I heard it. I saw it. I was witness to it. Yet and still, we have a more sure word of prophecy, more sure than for somebody who is an eyewitness of this. Whereunto ye do well that ye take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, unto the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. So what's the more sure word? This is the more sure word. This is more sure than having been there. This is more sure than having, I was on the mount with him. I saw them. I saw that we were in the cloud. I heard the voice. But yet and still, as you know, as awesome as that was, this word of God is even a greater revelation. This is a more sure word of prophecy than what I experienced. So Paul, the only time he actually like physically saw Jesus was he saw the light on the road to Damascus. And I went back and I read that passage. He never saw Jesus. He heard a voice. He saw a light. He fell down. His eyes were, you know, he couldn't see anything else. So he never, ever saw Jesus. Yet he got this massive revelation that we're living by. He got the revelation that the just shall live by faith. And this is, you know, he wrote books that are the foundation of what we believe right now because he had the revelation without ever seeing Jesus. Because sometimes, you know, I've heard ministers talk about it, so it can be a little hard to believe, you know, if you saw Jesus walking beside you or you saw him step to the side and have to go relieve himself or you saw him getting dirty and musty with you. So this is the Son of God. How can I believe that, you know, he's just like me. You start to draw comparisons, you know, and you can't understand that this man who clothed himself in flesh, because why would you do that anyway? Why would you clothe yourself in flesh and then walk beside me? So I've got to believe that this man that I'm eating with, that I'm walking with, who's just like me, who gets dirty, who has to comb his hair and they don't brush their teeth and, you know, all these different things, you know, he said, like sufferings, Jesus went through everything that they were going through. But I have to believe that this is the Son of God. So sometimes, you know, I know that there have been many of us who say, man, if I was just living in that time, if I could just see him do these miracles, if I could just walk next to him, all you need is the word of God. Meditate on this word and it can become just as real and more real to you as what Peter experienced, as what the disciples experienced. This word of God, it is God. This word is the living God. So if we fellowship in this word, we experience God. We experience Jesus more than Peter ever did, James, Thomas, anybody, because this word is who he is. So Peter was saying, I'm not just talking fairy tales for your entertainment. I'm telling you what I saw, yet and still there's a more sure word than what I've experienced. Now, if we go to Luke chapter 16, you know, okay, Peter, he even admitted that even though Paul had not been with them during the time that Jesus walked the earth, you know, Peter said, you know, there's some things that our brother Paul, he's blowing my mind. There's some things that I can't even understand. Now, I was with Jesus. This man has never seen Jesus, but he's dropping knowledge that's blowing my mind, and I was there. That's how much that revelation was impacting Paul, because he hadn't fellowshiped, you know, he hadn't just sat and ate with him, but he sat and ate from him. He fed on him. He spent time with him. He spent time speaking in tongues. Paul said, I speak in tongues more than you all. You know, that's fellowship with Jesus. That's just sitting and communing with Jesus. I don't need a fork or a spoon. I just need to sit there, speak in tongues, you know, and you're thinking, how many times have we just, you know, been through, walking through the house or cleaning up or whatever, just speak in tongues. Just wash dishes and speak in tongues. You're fellowshipping with him. You're spending time with them. And that time, they didn't have the Holy Ghost. Peter didn't have the Holy Ghost at the time that he was walking with Jesus. We have a more sure prophecy. We have a more sure experience with the word of God because we have this fellowship with God. And so if we go to Luke chapter 16, thank you, Jesus. And this is a parable about the rich man and Lazarus. And we know that, you know, they both died, and and Lazarus was in the bosom of Abraham, and the rich man, he was in hell. And he even, you know, he's still bossing Lazarus around, and he tells Abraham, send him to my brothers. I have brothers. You know, first he asked him to bring him, you know, just give me a drop of water. He said, just give me a little bit of anything, you know, to cool my tongue. But when that wasn't happening, he said, Abraham, could you just send him to my brothers? I have family that need to know. And if somebody who comes from the dead comes to them, maybe that'll be what they need to see to make them believe. And God, and Abraham told him in verse 29, chapter 16 of Luke, verse 29, Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. They have the word. Let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. If they see a dead man walking, they've got to believe. Verse 31, they may not believe because I'm not going to stay around long enough to hear what he has to say because you're dead. And yeah, I'm out. So verse 31, Abraham reiterates, and he said unto them, if you hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Even if they had have seen Lazarus walking in from the dead to say, guess where I just came from? Let me tell you, your brother, he's in hell, but you got an opportunity to save yourself. That still wouldn't have been enough. That still wouldn't have been in comparison to just getting into the Word of God. And he was referring to the Old Testament. We have the Old and the New Testament to be our guide. So here he's telling them, even if you saw this man, even if you saw Jesus in person like Peter did, even if you had a dead man come up to you and tell you that, that still would not compare to this Word of God that we have here. Everything we need is in this Word. This is all we need. This Word of God is the living Word of God. I praise God for that. Thank you, Lord. So if we go back to Romans 10, thank you for going back and forth with me. So we talked about, he's saying, who shall ascend in heaven? Who's going to bring Christ to us so we can believe? They didn't need for Christ to be there in the flesh for them to touch, because that wasn't going to make them believe any more than what they believe. If you can't hear, if you don't believe by me teaching you the Word of God, by me talking about the Word of God, speaking the Word of God, feeding on the Word of God, if that's not enough to save you, no manifestation is going to do it for you. Because how many of us have seen miracles? We've seen people be healed, people who were blind, seeing all these things, and we still talked ourselves out of, well, maybe, you know, that was just a medical miracle. Or I've heard that people who have been healed of blindness, their faith waned, and they were blind again. This is something that we have to believe. The Word of God has to be real for us. This has to be our personal experience. Now, you know, we are overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, but I need my own testimony. I have to live my life. I have to have faith, my own faith. You know, this is the life that I live. I live by the faith of the Son of God. And you can piggyback with me for a little while, but eventually you're going to have to stand on your own faith. And they had to understand, it's not about seeing Jesus. It's not about being in that moment, being on the Mount with them, the Mount of Transfiguration. None of that is what affected their salvation. It's believing this word for yourself. So if we go to verse 8, he said, but what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is a word of faith which we preach. He's saying, I gave it to you. I preached it to you. I know you know it. All you have to do, you know, you've got what you need. I preached the word to you. He said that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You've got to believe the word of God. He said, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now, I've said myself many times when I've been up here, you know, it's important that we watch our mouth, that we make sure that we're only speaking faith. And if we can't speak faith, don't say anything. However, if we are speaking, what we are speaking is a testimony to what we're believing. So it's important that we understand that what we speak is a result of what we believe. The Bible says in Proverbs 4:23, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. What I put in is what's going to come out. Out of my heart comes the issues of life. So I'm to guard my mouth. I'm to keep my mouth. And even the New International Version says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. So it's important that I watch what I'm putting in my heart, because what comes out of my heart is what I believe. So I can say, yes, watch what you speak, but it's not enough just to not say it. We've got to get to the root of the problem, find out why we're saying what we're saying, so we can affect what we continue to say. I'm not, you know, pressure's going to come and it'll cause us to speak what we're experiencing. But if we get in the Word of God and we change what's in our heart so that what comes out is different from what was coming out, we've got to get to the root. We've got to get into our hearts. We've got to make sure that we're feeding our hearts the Word of God, because that's what's going to come out. It's not just about confession, praise God. Luke chapter 6, verse 45 says, a good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So we can tell that evil man, stop talking. But then we've also got to tell that man, you've got to change your heart. You've got to get in the word, and you've got to begin to change what's going on in your heart, so that what comes out is not going to be evil anymore. If our response to speaking unbelief is only to stop speaking, then it's like a doctor giving you just, you know, giving treating the illness instead of fixing and curing the illness. How many, the pharmaceutical industry is becoming, is a billion, multi-billion dollar industry because they look for treatments for the symptoms. They don't really want to cure you, because if they cure you, then the money stops, then you won't come back again. Prescriptions are so widespread. I heard something say, if I can remember it correctly, but someone said that people are taking more prescriptions now in the last year than they took over the last 10 years, because they're constantly coming up with treatments for the symptoms. Condition that I have is giving me headaches. Let's not fix the condition, but I got something for your headache. So it's important that we understand, we don't just want to fix the symptoms. We don't just want to stop talking. We don't want to just, you know, I'm going to stop talking. No, we've got to get to the heart of the situation and fix the condition and cure the condition. This word of God is the cure for what ails you, praise God. So we understand, again, this is a cause and effect thing. Out of the abundance of the mouth, the heart speaks. So again, I'm speaking what's in my heart. Everybody here has had a baby, so none of us after finding out we were pregnant said, how did that happen? That makes no sense to wonder how it happened. Neither should we wonder if we've got things coming out of our mouth that's not of faith. We've got to go back and see what we did to cause this fruit that we're producing. This was not just random. There's something that we were feeding on, some action that we took that produced this unbelief or this lack of faith that came, that produced this from our hearts. And that's what we're speaking. We're speaking from what's in our heart. What farmer is going to say is going to plant all this seed, going to plant all these cornfields, and then walk out one day, where did all this corn come from? You planted corn seed. That's exactly the harvest that you're supposed to receive, because that's what you planted. If this evil man out of the evil of his heart is speaking evil things, somewhere along the line, he fed himself evil. Somewhere along the line, you know, those 4 or 5 hours of TV a day got down in us and started producing unbelief. Somewhere in us, the time we were spending with people who were speaking unbelief began to build up unbelief in us. So therefore, how do we treat that somewhere down the line? We've got to change what we're listening to, change who we're spending time with, and we've got to change what's on the inside of us. So out of the treasures of our heart, the mouth speaks. So if I want to speak faith, I've got to start getting in faith. I've got to start listening to faith. I've got to start talking faith. Again, I'm not trying to promote, oh, buy my CDs, whatever. It's free on YouTube. It's cool. But it's not enough just to come on Sundays and Thursdays and every other whatever to get in faith. We've got to feed on this word. This has got to be something. This has got to be a lifestyle. And I think it's so interesting that God leads me to say that almost every time I get up here, because it's very important that we understand that being in the Word of God, it's a lifestyle. This is something we have to have. Without exception, we're not going to change what's in our heart until we change what we put in our heart. Praise God. So again, the seed of what we believe is produced by what we've been feeding ourselves. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13 says, we have the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore we speak. So what came first? We believed, and then we spoke. Yes. Cause and effect. Praise God. So what you believe, if you're saying things and you kind of listen, start listening to what you say. Even earlier today, that God, I just thank God, because I've really been trying to watch what I speak. But, you know, again, we have to get to the root of it. But it comes, you know, God quickened me when I said it, and I heard what I said, you know, and I changed what I said, you know, so that it wouldn't be a statement of unbelief. But I knew that it was something that I had to start addressing, you know. And I thank God, God will prompt you. He'll put up a little finger and say, hey, did you hear what you just said? You know, if you listen, there's a still small voice on the inside of us that is telling us, are you sure that's what you wanted to confess? Are you sure that's what you wanted to say in this moment? Oh my God, what's going to happen? He's going to die. Shut up. Are you sure? Are you? So instead, we've got to start treating Not the symptoms, but we've got to start getting to the condition and get in the Word of God and start changing what we say. And then out of the abundance of the mouth, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak, but it'll speak faith. Praise God. Hallelujah. So I went to a couple of funerals yesterday, and this gentleman that I hadn't seen in a long time came up to me, and before I said, praise the Lord, good, he started telling me, you know, well, we don't have enough money, and we're going through this, and he gave me this laundry list of all these things that they were going through. And literally, at the end of everything he said, because I'm just like, okay, at the end of everything he said, I guess we gotta just trust God now. What? How much would his life have been changed if he had started with that? Everything else would have changed. I mean, I could, it hurt my heart. You know, I didn't have time to sit there and do a Bible study, but how are we addressing our situations? If our last resort is Jesus, we got this all wrong. We got this all messed up. If we trust God and we seek first the kingdom of God, if we seek him first, he'll take care of everything else. But it all comes, we got to trust that he is who he said he is, and that he's committed himself to providing for us, to doing everything that he would say, that he said he would do. That's why faith is impossible to please him without faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God, because he wants us to believe that he's just as good as he says he is. And if every time we're dealing with something,
it's not hard. You know, all you have to do is convince yourself. You know, and when I got saved, everything started to change. It was no work of my own.
Right.
You know, just by getting in the Word and getting to know him, things started to change.
He about made me mad, because he literally... He was coming to church off and on, and unbeknownst to me, he had kind of decided amongst himself... Him and God had worked it out that, you know what, I'm going to be saved. And this man, I had offered to buy him the patch. God was still dealing with me, because when he was in the throes of his drinking, I was very, very condemning. I was very judgmental, and God was working on me, and he was trying to take that out, because I kept trying to fix him. And I told y'all before, I kept trying to fix my husband. And the moment I stopped trying to fix my husband and began to work on me and began to say, God, here I am, Lord, you know, and just, you know, I just laid my heart out and said, well, you know what, Lord, maybe if you work on me, then I'll get out the way. And that's exactly what happened. The moment I used to go to church. I would go to church every single Sunday, and I would make a point to say, you coming to church? You know, just trying to point out the fact, oh, so you're not going to church again. It was very important to me that I made him understand just how sinful he was and how holy I was, because I went to church every Sunday, and here another Sunday, and you didn't go. And I just that condemnation, and God started to show me, look at yourself, you know, I got Vernon. Let's work on Lachelle. And as I started, you know, just letting God change me, I literally, you know, it didn't even bother. And it bothered me that he wasn't going to church. And I think at some point it kind of shocked him, because he was so used to me coming with that he was like, you know, he started going to church, and I would look up and he would be getting dressed, or he would come to me and say, what am I wearing today? What do you mean, what are you wearing today? I mean, it hadn't even crossed my mind whether he was going to church or not, because it wasn't my problem. It wasn't my situation. You're God. God, that's yours now. Work on me. And I completely, you know, had, you know, removed myself from that situation. And it was in that moment that I let go that God began to work in his life. And literally, God just changed him. Oh, it felt like overnight, because he stopped drinking, he stopped smoking. All these things just came to him naturally. No patch, no, you know, and he stopped doing all these things. And it wasn't because I was condemning him, or I was like, why are you going out every weekend? I stopped all that, you know, and not to give me any glory, but God had so much to work on with me that I really, if I, you know, worked on me first, I didn't have time to go back and, you know, take care of what needed to be fixed in Vernon. And look at what God did in his life. And I praise God for that, because it's not, you know, I'll keep going, because there's something is in this that's fascinating that kind of deals with the fact that what James is saying. Let me get to where I'm going. So, and then it's very important, if we're believing for something and this is all in the midst of my flow, but I was reading, and if we're believing for something big, we can't expect it to immediately happen overnight. We've got to build our faith gradually. You know, if I'm believing for a $500,000 house, I'm not going to sow a $20 seed and then be expecting somebody to, you know, Publishers Clearing House to be knocking on the door. You know, I looked up mammals, and the elephant is giving birth to an elephant, and she is pregnant for 23 to 25 months. Yes. Because she's giving birth to an elephant. If I want a house, it's going to take me working on my faith. There may be a time when it won't take me 23 to 25 months to produce my elephant. But as long as I'm praying for this elephant or this house or whatever this big thing is in my life, I've got to do some building up because I'm working on something. Now, the smallest mammal is a possum, you know, and they literally are pregnant for 7 to 12 days. And they can produce. So if we're believing for God to, oh, I just need you to work this little thing out. Yeah, I have enough faith for that. But all I'm giving birth to is a possum. But if I'm only giving, you know, we have to understand that I can't say, God, what happened if I'm believing for this big thing and it doesn't show up overnight? It does not mean that God failed me. It does not mean that God didn't come through. It means that my faith needs some more developing. It means I need to get in the Word of God and start working out my faith anymore that I can go pick up a 300-pound weight my first time in the gym, I look like a foolish woman. I would look completely insane. But those little dumbbells, the little 5-pound, 3-pound ones, oh, I can work that out because I can handle that. And that's what my faith can handle sometimes. And if that's where you are, stay there and just keep lifting those because eventually you're going to see some results from lifting those 3-pound weights and lifting those 5-pound weights. And then you can go to the 10-pound weights. This is a gradual walk. You know, it said in Deuteronomy that he would clear out the nations little by little. God, when he was talking to the Israelites, he told Moses, I gave you all this, he said, but I'm not going to take them all at once because if we clear them out all at once, then it's just like if we clear out everything and we just stop going cold turkey, there's all kinds of nonsense that can show up. They can see all this empty space and everybody goes crazy, and then you're dealing with 10 times as many nations. But he said, little by little, I'm going to clear them out. Little by little, even though they're stronger and bigger than you, there are things that we're dealing with that are stronger and bigger than us and we don't know how we're going to take them. But if we just go to God and say, God, you may not change everything about me tomorrow, but let's just work on this. Lord, I give my smoking to you, Lord. Today, I just want to work on my smoking habit. I love you, and I know that you love me, and every time I smoke this cigarette, I just remind myself that I'm the righteousness of God, and I know that you're going to take that away from me, and I thank you that while I'm working on this little thing, I am not in condemnation because I'm not under condemnation because I'm not under the law, but I can work on this thing knowing that you're still got a whole lot of things you're working on me, but I'm not going to be in condemnation about these, but I'm submitting myself to you in this area, and God was just, he'll take that and he will change it. He will change it. Just give it to him and don't let Satan tell you that you're working on that one little thing, but look at this hot mess that you got going on. Yeah, I know, but God is working. I know he's working. At all times, we have to be fully confident that God is working, no matter what it is. It may not happen overnight. And not to say, all these caveats, not to say that it can't, but if it doesn't mean God can't, it doesn't mean he won't, and it doesn't mean that you're failing or lacking. Just give it to God and trust him. He's doing a work. He's doing a work. How many have had those situations where you pray for something and then months later you get it, but you had forgotten that you even prayed for it? There are times that we've just said, you know what, I believe it. And then, I mean, like I told you last time, there are things I have to write down, things that I'm believing God for, because I'll go back and look and say, I forgot I was even praying for that. But he never forgot it. He still remembered, and he still went to work at that time, and that manifestation was coming, and he had it all worked out, and we just got to trust that he doesn't forget. He hears our prayers. Praise God. God has not forgotten. So now let's go back to James 2. Because we read about, you know, we believe in our heart, and we out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And then Romans 10:10, it says, "With the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." So we have that. But if we go back to James 2, because we're trying to, we're doing what Martin Luther was doing. He had to reconcile Romans. That says that we are saved by faith with James, that says in chapter 2 that We have to have works. So again, if we go to chapter 2 of James, we read verse 14. It says, if a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not these things which are needful to the body, what does it profit? And notice his example. His example is, if somebody's naked or hungry and we don't give them anything, what does it profit? James understood that he was not saved by faith, or that he was not saved by works. But he also understood that faith worketh by love. So if I'm really pregnant, there's going to be a baby that comes. I'm not going to work to have a baby. It's the natural, organic result of getting pregnant. That's what happens naturally. So it's not that I got to prove to you I'm pregnant by having a baby. I'm pregnant, therefore, I'm going to have a baby. So if we have true faith, there's supposed to be the fruit of love. Romans 5:5 says, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. God has shed his love abroad in us through the Holy Ghost. There's love on the inside of us. We have Jesus on the inside of us. We have love on the inside of us, and that love is supposed to produce works of love. So James is not saying that it's your works that are going to save you, create the faith to save you. But he's saying that if you have faith and your faith is real, then the result of this real faith that you have are fruit of love, are fruits of, and again, he gave the specific question. If I'm really in faith and my faith is working by love, and again, this love is a two-sided coin. We talk about faith worketh by love, and my faith worketh by the fact that I'm convinced that God loves me. I'm convinced that he died for me. I'm convinced that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. When I become convinced of that, you know, then my faith worketh by love. But I also have to understand that my faith worketh by understanding his love. But as I get in faith, then I'm able to show love. I'm able to express love because I have the faith to believe. I can show love to my husband's ex-girlfriend because I'm convinced of his love for me. I don't have to treat women funny when they walk up to him. I used to, but I don't do that anymore because I'm confident in his love for me. So when I become confident in his love for me, my faith in his love for me can allow me to express love to others because of how I know that he loves me. So I'm not going to treat anybody funny. The ex-girlfriend comes up, gives him a hug. She got to go home eventually. I'm not worried about it because he's coming home with me. It's the truth, though. I mean, we have to bring this down to a natural understanding. I can know that my faith is working because I'm confident in God's love for me. And this, the bottom line is, if I understand that God loves me, if I have the faith to believe that he loved me so much, he gave his son, and with his son, he gave me life and that more abundantly. He gave me all these wonderful things. He's going to take care when I have a need, he'll take care of my need because I know he loves me. And so if somebody comes to me and they are hungry and they are naked, I don't have to say, man, I'd like to give, but I got to make sure I got enough for tomorrow. I can give because I know if I'm giving, I'm in partnership with God, and he's going to take care of whatever seed I sow into their life, because I'm not just giving, I'm sowing. And it says in 2 Corinthians that we have the opportunity to give under every good work because we know that he's supplying all my needs. Paul said, my God. He didn't say God. He said my God because it was his God. It's my God that will supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. And when I have the confidence that he's going to supply all my needs, it's nothing for me to show love to you because I know if I've got $100 and I give you $50, God's going to give me $100 back, and I'll have more than what I started with because he loves me. And it's that faith that produces that work of love. That's what James was talking about. If you really have faith, he's not saying act like you have faith and then you're going to do, these are the things that you're going to do to prove that you have faith. He's saying if you really have faith, the the direct result of true faith is these acts, these works of love. And there are things that we've been believing for, and we sow a seed. Okay, I'm going to sow $10, but I'm believing for $10,000. How much faith am I in? Because I don't want to give more than my $10 because I'm going to need this. I may need this later on. I'm hoarding because I'm scared that God is not going to supply my needs. Like he said, I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. The cattle are mine. The hills are mine. What do I have to, you know, I don't ask for you to give me tithes because I need your money. God is telling, I don't need this. This is just an act of faith because I want you to prove that you love me. And God showed me in the same way that he went to Abraham and he told him, he said, you know, give me your son, your only son. And he had him going to, you know, to sacrifice his son, praise God. And as he sacrificed his son, I heard a minister say that as he was going up the hill, he had a goat going up the other, on the other side of the hill. So God had asked this of him, but he was making provision even before he ever got there. God has provision for us. There's nothing that you're going to give up for them. And Abraham knew. He said, you know what? I'm going to give my son. And I don't know if God has to raise him from the dead, but I know good and well that if I give up something for God, he's got something for me. And that same test that he gave to Abraham, he did to the rich young ruler. Abraham passed. The rich young ruler failed. He went to the rich young ruler for everybody to see. Oh, good master, good master. He did the same thing saying, oh, you know, I believe, I trust, you know. And he did all these things, but Jesus tested his heart just like he tested Abraham's. And he said, give all that you have, sell it all, and give it to the poor. And he said, I've got more for you. But he did not have the faith to believe. He was not working. He did not believe that God was going to be everything that he said he was going to be. Abraham knew that you're gonna have a ram, you're going to raise him from the dead. I don't know how you're going to do it, but you're going to do it. And we don't have to know how he's going to do it, but we got to know he's going to do it. The rich young ruler, he had faith. He's like the Israelites in Romans 10 was saying, you know what? I worked really hard to earn all this money, you know, and I know you're good and I know you're God. Actually, he took it back. He said, because Jesus asked him, he said, why callest thou me good? And he said, you know what? You're right, master. And he went back to him and he took the good from, because he didn't really believe how good God was. But we know how good God is. He's so good. And we begin to understand that God is just as good as he said he is. And this God of all creation loves me, and I can give of everything that I have. I can show love. I can be a blessing if somebody does wrong to me. God has changed me so much. God has changed me so much. I've told y'all, I used to hold grudges to the point that I didn't remember what I was mad about, but I got to make sure you understand, I'm still mad at you. You're not just going to get away with that. But the Bible says, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, and I will repay. He fights my battles. You know, and that's why the peace that I have is passes all understanding, because you don't understand. Did you see what she said to you? Did you see what he did to you? Do you know what just happened? How you just going to take that? The world will try to ramp you up. You'll get out in situations. How you just going to take that? He took it for me. I know he took it for me. Hallelujah. And he's going to take care of everything. I trust God. It all comes down to I trust him, and my trust comes from because I love him, because I know he loves me. My confidence in his love produces these works of love. And that's what James was saying. If we go back to James chapter 2, he's saying, in verse 16, he said, if one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding you give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? What did your faith do? Be ye warmed and filled. You just pat them on the head and send them on their way. They still hungry. Why? God says, I'm giving to you so that you can give unto every good work, and you can have the faith to believe that if you're giving, there's more coming. I'm a conduit. I'm a faith worketh by love. You know, it go, you know, we were saved by grace through faith. Faith, you know, it's a tunnel. You know, that grace went through faith. We had to believe in order to receive the grace that God had for us. In the same way, we have to be able to give. God sends blessings. He doesn't have money. He doesn't have these things in the kingdom, but he gives them to us so that we can, because we have the faith to believe that he's going to restore anything that we give, anything that we lose, we're going to get it back. And it's that belief that allows us to just be givers, to be lovers. If somebody comes in and they do us wrong, they treat us wrong, we got to get to the point where we can't even remember what they did. We got to be able to let that stuff go, because he forgave me. He forgave them. And he's got something so much better for me that I could be preventing for myself because I want to stay mad about something. Let the petty go. Life is too short and God is too good. So we've got to make sure that we just trust God and know he's taking care of it. He's got it. He's got it. He's a big enough God to handle everything, the little things and the big things, praise God. He said, so if we've got to be the one to warm them, we've got to be the one to fill them, we've got to be the one to minister to them, praise God. And in verse 17, he said, even so, if faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. What good is my faith if it's not bringing about something, if it's not producing something? Yes, I had the faith. I got saved. I had the faith to believe. I have faith now. But why would I just stop here? I'm going to heaven and I'm so glad. My faith is supposed to do something. And here we have to go back to Mark 11. Let's go to Mark 11 and that'll be what we do last. Hallelujah. Mark 11, they were going, it says in verse 12, and on the morrow when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. Jesus was hungry, and he saw a fig tree afar off having leaves. He came, if happily he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. And Jesus answered and said unto it, no man eat fruit of thee hereafter. Why did he do that to that? What did that tree do to him? It's the same thing James is saying. If you really have faith, you're supposed to be producing. If you call yourself a fig tree, there's supposed to be figs on you. That it's not saying that this fig tree had to work to produce fruit. We plant seeds, we produce an apple tree. That apple tree, we don't have to lay hands on it to say, Lord, please generate apples from this tree. Hallelujah, Jesus. That apple tree is going to organically, naturally produce fruit. It's going to produce apples. In the same way, we are, you know, we're children of God, and we're supposed to organically, naturally produce love. This is supposed to come from love. We're supposed to, love is supposed to come from us. And that's what James says. What's the use of being a fig tree if you don't have any figs on you? What's the use of being a child of God if you're not walking in love? What's the purpose? He's saying this is what's supposed to happen. Don't do this to prove you have love. This is what's supposed to happen. And then we go to Mark 11, Mark 16. It's saying we have to believe. Wait a minute. And it is perverse for a fig tree in harvest time to not have a tree, to not have a fig, just as it's perverse for a believer not to produce works of love. So once I get saved, it doesn't stop there. There's supposed to be fruit that I produce for as I continue to live this life, if I continue to feed on the word of God. This is a ministry. We can get people saved, get them speaking in tongues with the Holy Ghost, but we lose so many people because we stop there. Because after they speak in tongues and we get them, okay, you got a place in heaven, we got a seat reserved, now we have to begin to disciple them. We've got to begin to teach them how to produce this fruit. We've got to, in our own selves, some maybe that's why we're not teaching, because we're still learning ourselves. We got to make sure we're producing the fruit of love, praise God. So the belief comes, and then what we speak. And if we go to Mark 16, verse 17, and these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. So he's saying these signs are supposed to follow them that believe. These works are supposed to follow them that believe. This is supposed to be a sign of your belief that you are going to cast out devils in my name. You're going to speak in new tongues in my name. These are supposed to be the organic effects of our faith. and last but not least, Luke 13:6, Jesus, he spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon and found none. Then he said unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth up the ground? You're just taking up space. And he answered unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also till I shall dig about and dung it. Everybody knows what dung is? And if it bears fruit, well, and if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. I don't want to be that tree. And so if God sees that I'm not producing fruit, Lord, work with me. Develop this fruit of love in me. Help me to just, you, if you got to send a little dung my way, so be it. Do whatever you have to do so that I can begin to produce the fruit of love. God wants to work on us. He wants to dig around in us. And sometimes there's some things that may not always be pleasant, you know, but he's producing some things in us. He wants to see a harvest in us. And it's going to take some faith. It's going to take some things where we have to buckle down and really get in this word. But they're supposed to be fruit. They're supposed to be fruit. And I praise God, and I trust that we're going to begin to even more show the fruit of love in our lives. Amen? Amen. Amen.